Okay, so I'm going to talk to you about Domina, the Women Who Made Imperial Rome. Now, this is a book that's just been published by Yale University Press. Let me explain from the outset two things. Domina, you may be hugely disappointed to discover it's not about dominatrixes and anything else particularly kinky. Domina means the mistress of the household, and it comes from the word domus for the house. And, of course, it gives us the word domesticated, and dominus is the master of the household. This is the formal title of any senior woman of status in the Roman world, and particularly in the Roman imperial family, and it was used by them. So it's quite an important word, but at the same time I realise it's not something everybody's familiar with. Now, the fundamental thesis behind this book was essentially quite simple, which is that the Julio-Claudian dynasty only happened because the bloodline was passed down through the women. Blatantly obvious fact, which one would have thought would have been made more of in the past, but actually hasn't really been so. Now, also to make it clear what the book is really about, when I wrote it, what was completely clear to me is that although women were not restricted by office because they couldn't hold it, they were not therefore legally contained within the framework of office, which gave them a remarkable amount of autonomy outside that. They were at the same time paradoxically limited by having to express that power through men. So predominantly, a woman had to act via her husband or her son, and that was the entrapping paradox for them. So in one sense they were quite free, but actually they were hugely limited. And I don't want you to get the impression that women are somehow the unique victims. It's very easy to take a rather a cliched feminist line on this. In fact, virtually all the men in this dynasty suffered similarly degrading and humiliating deaths. Most of the women do. So do virtually all of the men. In a sense, they're all victims of the system, but in different ways. Right, so kicking off then, I'm going to go through this fairly quickly because it's quite a long PowerPoint, and I'm mindful that there's the tea break and everything else in the second lecture to go through. Those are the first five Roman emperors. You'll all have heard of them: Augustus, Tiberius, Caligula, Claudius, and Nero. They are all members of the Julio-Claudian dynasty, and basically what that refers to is the Augustan side and his wife Livia's side, and those are the two family origins, and they're all descended from that. But not one of these men is the son of his predecessor. And the validation through the dynasty, which is what Augustus was trying to establish, is through the bloodline, and it has to come down through the female line. I think it's important to point out, there was not supposed to be a monarchy. There was not supposed even really to be a Roman emperor. So Augustus has pretended that he is recreating the Republic, while at the same time trying to establish a dynasty in a system that wasn't supposed to have any such thing as a ruling family. So that is something that he's up against from the outset, and he has a lot of problems, as we'll see. What's the inspiration for this? Well, I bought this coin. It was struck at Ephesus. It's a Christophorus. And if you're wondering, it's right here. That's it. Struck in 51 AD, and there is Claudius, the emperor, with his wife, Agrippina the Younger, who was also his niece. Now, we'll get on to that sort of radical family way of running things in a bit. But this coin fascinated me because it is unique in the Roman series. There we have a couple of joint rulers. I'm going to come back to it later. When I bought that coin, I was just mesmerized by this double-headed portrait. Never happened before, and it didn't happen again. Well, and we'll find out about that later. Right, where do women sit in Roman society? Well, if you go to Valerius Maximus, who was a senator who wrote in the days of Tiberius, he wrote down lots of anecdotes and stories, and that's what he says. What business has a woman with a public meeting? That's how he opens one section, and he answers his question straight away by saying, nothing whatsoever, if you're going to follow tradition. So this is a very important distinction. In the Roman world, women do not have public status in a formal sense. They are not supposed to be any part of the governmental system or voting. But I do not want you to conclude from that therefore they did not have power, because that would not be true. And we'll have a look at how that power could manifest itself. It goes right the way back to the earliest Roman tradition. Tarpeia was a Roman woman who, well, the story is this. The Romans raped the Sabine women, took the Sabine women to bring them into Rome in order to elevate the numbers of childbearing women in Rome. That meant they wanted more women in. The Sabines come, not surprisingly, to get their women back. And Tarpeia, who is a high-born Roman woman, she lets the Sabines in because she is tempted by their offers of jewels and gold. The Sabines come in, thanks to Tarpeia. They are so disgusted by her disloyalty, they kill her, even though she's let them in. But the thing about Tarpeia is that she's in Roman tradition as the bad side of women. There is the woman's fatal susceptibility to luxury and wealth. And this is how the Romans depicted women in a negative sense, as a rhetorical device. So Tarpeia is the bad side of the Roman woman because she's giving way to luxury. Lucretia, who was raped by the son of the last of the kings of Rome, Tarquinius Superbus. Lucretia, of course, as a result of having been raped, her chastity, her honor has been destroyed. Therefore, she commits suicide. She's the good side of the Roman woman because she recognizes that she, what would have made her valuable, admirable as a Roman woman, has been compromised. She does the honorable thing and takes her own life. Now, this cuts right to the heart of the Roman perspective on women, which is that women tend to be pigeonholed as one or the other. But I would emphasize that these are, strictly speaking, rhetorical devices in Roman society, and therefore there's a great liking to pigeonhole a woman in one or the other. And this all hinges on the concept of pudicitia. Now, pudicitia is pure sexual chastity. It could, in fact, be applied to a man, but a woman's pudicitia is something that is so ethereal and elevated. It's a kind of magical, supreme quality of femininity, but it's incredibly fragile. It can be punctured by the slightest questioning, which is why Caesar divorces one of his wives, simply because there had been some allegation that she might have been implicated in an affair, not anything to do with her, and she hadn't in fact been really, but he said, "My wife must be beyond suspicion." Very famous quote. So pudicitia, it's just one word, but it carries so many connotations in the Roman world, and a woman would need to keep her pudicitia absolutely perfectly intact if she was going to maintain her status, and more importantly, to the men, her pudicitia would elevate and amplify their status. To have a wife with immaculate pudicitia made you a better and more important man, a more admirable man. Fecunditas, I'm sure you all know what that means. Fecunditas, fertility. So, of course, this is central also to the woman's role within the Roman family, which is to reproduce children and to keep the line going along, because of course in the Roman family that is an essential way of passing down through the dynasty property and status. So fecunditas, fertility, something highly venerated in the Roman world. If a woman did not have children, this was going to be a serious issue for her. But let's not forget, it was extremely dangerous for women in those days. Death in childbirth was extremely common. Pliny the Younger talks about a couple of young women that he knew who had died in childbirth, and how terribly sad he was talking about that. Now, that was writing in the early second century, but it's a very touching letter when he refers to that. A girl's education. Well, think of the world of Jane Austen. This is a world in which you were supposed to stay at home. You would. Some girls were well educated, and by the more far-thinking fathers, certainly in better-off families. But even then, a woman was generally supposed to confine herself to domestic affairs and develop her skills as the mistress of a household. So she would learn things like basic music and sewing and weaving, and she might learn to read and write, but there was no expectation in most cases that she would ever formally take part in public life, and that was frowned upon. You'll notice in that painting from Pompeii on the left how her skin is a lighter colour, and of course that reflects the preference for women to remain indoors within the household. So that quite distinctive colour difference, which is still, you know, appears in some cultures today. marriage and expectations. So you might be married, you might be betrothed from infancy as a Roman female, but by the time you were 13, 14 years old, you might well be married. And you could well be having your children by your mid to late teens. And in many cases, of course, those women might not outlive that period or outlive their 20s. So it's not unusual to find Roman men marrying a second or even a third time because their wives had died in the interim. And Pliny the Younger, who I mentioned earlier on, he did marry a teenage girl when he was well into his late 40s, I think, and had a very happy third marriage. But he was basically married to a schoolgirl by our standards. But that was not unusual in those days. And the expectation of the woman is that everything about her life and behavior will be for the purpose of amplifying her husband's status and achievements. And when Pliny talks about his young wife, he's very, very admiring of how she accompanies him to public events, but stays on the other side of a curtain, outside, writing notes and supporting him, but out of sight, and being in that rather subordinate role. And that's how the Roman mentality worked. Now, if we jump all the way on to the Second Punic War in the 3rd century BC, when the Romans were fighting their great enemy of Carthage, a law was passed during that war to restrict the ownership of purple and gold. And it was precisely to save money in this war because the city was under extraordinary jeopardy, an exceptionally dangerous situation for the Roman world, and they didn't want to waste any money. Now, after the war was over in 195 BC, the women of Rome riot because they say the war is over, we want to go back to getting our gold and purple. So they have a whole sort of mob demonstration in Rome. Now, the die-hard male conservatives of the Romans are totally disgusted by this, because they think this is typical of women. They just want to go back to luxury and decadence. And some Roman men are keen for the law to be changed. But the old conservatives know they're disgusted, and they think this is a perfect example of why women shouldn't have anything. And it's critical. It's this idea of effeminacy. Now, in Latin, in the Roman world, you can effeminate somebody. So these effeminate characteristics of degenerate interest in luxury and gold, this is a power and a force women have to degenerate men. And Mark Antony was considered to have been effeminated by his wife Fulvia and then by Cleopatra. Valerius Maximus, who I mentioned earlier, that's a quote from him, imbecilitas mentis, basically simplicity of mind. That's what he put down their behaviour to, these women wanting their luxury and gold. A sort of almost mental backwardness. So I hasten to add, I'm not extolling these, I'm just explaining that this is how they thought. Then, of course, you get somebody like Cornelia Africana. Cornelia Africana was the daughter of Scipio Africanus, the great general of the Second Punic War. She was also the mother of the Gracchi brothers, the reforming tribunes of the plebs in the late 2nd century BC. Cornelia Africana was venerated in Roman society because of her role as a mother in educating and bringing up her sons and her esteemed family status. She was, as is typical for these occasional prominent women, validated, defined by the fact that she was her father's daughter and her son's mother. But she was still seen as being integral to their status and identity. But because she did all the right things, cultivated her sons, participated in education and learning, she was venerated. That statue base stood in the Porticus of Octavia in Rome for centuries after her life. The statue, of course, long gone. Now, women outside their sphere. There are occasionally instances where women have the effrontery to step outside their sphere. Hortensia, Afrania, and Maesia are all women from the late Republic who defended cases in court. Hortensia, for example, defended the interests of women whose husbands had been heavily taxed by Augustus and Antony in the Civil War period. And her speech was preserved, and it was hugely admired as a great piece of court speaking, in the sense of a law court. She was trained in it. through her family background. So we have an exceptionally unusual instance here of a woman not only expressing and defending in court, but actually being admired for doing so. Afrania and Maesia did the same thing, but in Afrania's case, Valerius Maximus describes her as listening to a dog barking. It's a really pejorative way of diminishing her achievements by equating her speaking in court to a dog barking. Maesia was described as androgyne, which means male-female. It's not clear whether that's an insult, whether she's a man-like woman, or whether he was saying that, they were saying, the people who called her that, that in fact she was almost admirable because she had developed some male qualities. But it remains the fact that these women were extremely unusual. But it is interesting that you could get these exceptions. There was even a special word for a talkative woman, a lingularca. Lingularca is also the word for a tongue, and it's also the word for the soul fish, because of course that looks like a tongue. And therefore, in Roman society, generally speaking, a lingularca is an insulting term for a woman. It diminishes her in the eyes of others. Being over-talkative is not a great thing. It's better to keep your mouth shut. And you see the same sort of thing. It does come up in sometimes the works of Jane Austen. You can see the sort of reflection of this enduring culture. Now, when we get on to the historical period that we're talking about, Caesar and Cleopatra. Cleopatra, you've all heard of her. Cleopatra the Seventh of Egypt. The Romans are presented with a woman who is a monarch in her own right. She is highly intelligent. She is multilingual. She is brilliant as a political manipulator. And she also knew how to work Caesar and Antony. And the fascinating thing about her is that the Romans are clearly hugely titillated by this woman. She presents them with a real crisis of how to deal with a woman of that sort of status. She remains so admired that the statue of Cleopatra, it's not that one, because the one that was of Cleopatra was made of gold, Julius Caesar stuck it in his temple, in his forum, even though that was supposed to reflect his descent from Venus. He actually sticks a statue of his mistress in the temple. Well, it was there for centuries later, because later Roman historians describe it. It was never removed. So this fascination with Cleopatra endured. Now, Cleopatra's going to pop up again in a minute. Fulvia was the wife of Mark Antony, one of his earlier wives. Fulvia had been married before. She was a major political agitator. Here we have a woman who, in the Republic, where a woman is not supposed to have status, she was a military commander, not actually in terms of a general, but she certainly gave orders to armies. She works alongside Antony to the extent that people regarded them as effectively joint consuls of Rome. But the way Roman historians describe her later is that they are disgusted by Fulvia. And why hadn't she been satisfied with staying at home spinning, says one historian. They can't believe it. And she is believed by them to have effeminated Mark Antony. She is the one that later historians said Cleopatra should have been grateful to, because Fulvia had so softened up and effeminated Mark Antony, she prepared him for Cleopatra's wiles. Heaven forbid that Mark Antony could have been responsible for his fall himself. No, it has to be the evil degenerative characteristics of a woman. So of course, as you all know, Cleopatra the Seventh, she ends up having a monumental affair with Mark Antony. That's a coin of the two of them. In the middle is Octavia. Now, Mark Antony by now is a political associate of Octavian, the future Augustus. Octavian and Antony arrange a marriage in which Antony marries Octavian's sister Octavia. It's a dynastic alignment, but Antony dumps Octavia for the sake of marrying Cleopatra, and even planning to hand over that half of the Roman Empire to his descendants with Cleopatra. Now, this is what destroys Antony in the eyes of the Romans. But as I've just said, his collapse is based on these women, not Octavia. Octavia, of course, is enhanced by this. She is the victim of Antony's degenerative effeminacy, and she becomes a bastion of the future dynasty. Cicero and Horace, two of the most famous Roman writers, these men are transfixed by the whole Cleopatra tradition. Reginam odi, I hate the queen, says Cicero. But he's so lascivious in his description of hatred, you can tell he's transfixed by her. Horace gives a whole ludicrous description of Cleopatra's court being full of perverted, drunken eunuchs and drug-taking lunatics. And he goes on about it. It becomes almost a trope to slag off Cleopatra. It's a way of enhancing your Roman virtues. Now we're going to get on to the Julio-Claudians proper. Now you may have seen the BBC HBO series Rome, and in the middle is Attia there, who grossly misrepresented in the programme. She, very little is known about her, and such as it is, suggests she was quite a demure woman. She was the niece of Julius Caesar, but she's the mother of Octavian. And that is the only reason that Octavian is adopted by Julius Caesar as his heir. Now, importantly, Octavian is therefore legally Caesar's son, but his dynastic entitlement has come through the female line, not through direct descent. But the Romans were always masking this and covering it up. Therefore, what happens is that he is fully presented to the world as Caesar's son and takes the name Gaius Julius Caesar. But the bloodline is through the females. Now, there's the emperors again. I'll just reiterate the fact: Augustus, Tiberius, Caligula, Claudius, and Nero. It is a dynasty, and we're going to look now at the relationships and how that operated and how this dynasty survived, how it got through to be the longest dynasty in Roman imperial history, about a century. Octavian's women. These women are going to play a very powerful role in his establishment of himself as Augustus Caesar, as the emperor, and how he is going to keep the dynasty going along. First of all, on the left, you have Octavia, his sister, whom I've always mentioned, already mentioned. We have his wife, Livia, not his first wife, but his most important wife. And on the right, we have his daughter, Julia the Elder, the only child that Augustus Caesar ever had. Now, these three women are going to become the dynastic linchpins of the Julio-Claudian dynasty, and they're the only way that he manages to establish his family in a sustained position of power, which, as I mentioned before, wasn't supposed to exist. The women have to subscribe to all the values and standards that I mentioned earlier about pudicitia and fecunditas. So he comes up with a whole list of moral reforms about marriage, about behavior. It's one something that all societies seem to go through, which is, oh, the bad old days, that's all. We've just had some terrible times. We've had lots of decadence. We need to go back to when we were a good society, to all the old standards. We need to restore all that. So he tries to enforce that, and these women become integral components of the image of the dynasty. Up till that point in the Roman Republic, it's all been a terribly male-masculine environment. Augustus is really the first to start integrating the status of women in his regime as a part of its image and reinforcing the standards that he wants in the world. So, for example, his sister Octavia, she becomes a benefactress. That's the porticus of Octavia in Rome. Only the porch survives to this day. This is a large place full of gardens and libraries and perhaps little theatres, places to relax. It was somewhere that ordinary people in Rome could go and enjoy some of the top end level of comfort in the city. And Octavia is there, here, providing that for the people. And it was in that building that the base of the statue of Cornelia Africana was found. So she's also putting into the building, I'll just wait for that to stop, because I can't talk with that.
Sorry.
Thank you. Right. So Cornelia Africana's statue sits in there as part of a whole panoply of illustrations of high quality women from the past, reinforcing this notion. And the porticus of Livia, Augustus's wife, by whom he had no children, that doesn't exist any longer, but the marble map of Rome shows the map, a plan of the building, and also the Shrine of Concordia, or harmony, within it. So this is extolling appropriate virtues to the state, to the society, to Rome, the Roman state. These are the qualities that Augustus wants to emphasize to everybody that his regime is bringing. And these female virtues are important. But let's not forget, these women are not holding any office within the society, but they do hold a lot of influence. Also very influential. If you go to Pompeii, there is the building of Eumachia. The building of Eumachia is the largest public building in Pompeii, and it was built by a lady in the early 1st century AD as an emulation of the porticus of Livia. It is a direct copy of it, but a kind of miniature version. So we have here a woman who was a widow in Pompeii. She is trying to improve the career prospects for her son, Marcus Numistrius Fronto, and she does this by providing this huge public building in her name and that of her son. And she directly copies the empress's role in Rome to do that within her own city. And there you can see the plan of the building at the bottom, and there at the back, there was in fact in that alcove a statue of Livia as Concordia. So this structure here provided some of the facilities of the porticus of Livia in Rome. Now, Augustus has his terrible nightmare of the succession. He has no son. He has got the daughter Julia, but that's not his plan. He has a nephew, though, Marcellus, by his sister Octavia. Marcellus is the golden boy. Marcellus is designated to be the successor. This is the way they're going to keep the bloodline. But the only reason he's eligible is that he's his sister's son. So we're already going for the female line, because that's the only option he has. Unfortunately, Marcellus dies as a very young man, and that plan is kiboshed. So he has to resort to the sons of his daughter Julia. Julia, by then, who had been married to Marcellus, she's now married to Augustus's general Agrippa, has several children by him, who include Gaius and Lucius Caesars. Augustus is delighted. He adopts them as his sons, talks about them as his boys, starts, in a sense, to cut his daughter and Agrippa out of it, although in that coin you can see Julia in the middle and Gaius and Lucius on either side. Well, that's a terrific plan. He's now got some boys who can inherit the state. And there they are advertised on a denarius for him at Gaius and Lucius Caesars. And it says round the top, Principis Juventitis. So the principal youth, they are the premier youth. There are these two boys, Gaius and Lucius Caesars, marked out here as future heirs, except that there wasn't supposed to be an emperor. So it's all a bit of a fudge, but it means that they are going to take on some of the republican offices that Augustus has held. Unfortunately, they both pop their clogs in the space of 2 years, between AD 2 and 4. There, his grandsons are gone. He therefore has to turn to his wife Livia and her son Tiberius by her previous husband, who'd come down the Claudian line, which is where the Claudian bit comes in. Now, Augustus is going to die in 14 AD, and Tiberius is going to inherit the throne. He has to be adopted as Augustus's son. He's not even related to Augustus. He is only his stepson through his wife Livia's previous marriage. So we've gone through three bouts of the female line now for Augustus to get a successor at all. Now, he doesn't, for a variety of reasons, have an empress. He does have a son called Drusus, and he does have grandsons eventually, and it does look like there's going to be a dynastic line there. That coin is him commemorating Augustus, the divine Augustus, the divine father Augustus. There is Tiberius associating himself with this father who wasn't his father. Unfortunately, he's stuck with the fact that Livia is one of the most powerful female figures in this whole story, and I can't even begin to go into it really, but because she doesn't have an empress to rival her, Tiberius doesn't have an empress, she therefore is able to hold a huge amount of power over him and is constantly reminding him that he is only emperor because of her. She manages to get legal cases twisted in her favour, her friend's favour. She uses influence like that. She takes every opportunity to maximise her influence over her son. Now, the Roman historian Tacitus spent a lot of time insinuating that Livia was an evil person who had seen to it that Augustus's other descendants had all been bumped off. And that is the basis of Robert Graves' book, I, Claudius. That she was a schemer and a plotter. I don't think that's the case. I think it's just happenstance. But Tacitus couldn't help himself. He loved the idea of women being self-serving and trying to commit evil. Now, as that matriarch, she's presented in all sorts of guises. There she is as Justitia, justice. There is Livia as the embodiment of justice during her son Tiberius's reign. And you can see up there, that says Tiberius Caesar. So she's managing to hold a huge amount of influence, but of course she holds no office. So all her influence is in the background, and it's through her son. Now she predeceases Tiberius, and that takes her out of the loop. She is really the only woman in this direct line. Octavia is gone by now, and Julia, who had been sleeping around with loads of people and having loads of affairs, she's been banged up in exile and is also dead. So Livia is the one who has actually ends up dying in her bed. Where are we left? What's going to happen to the Roman Empire now? Well, running along in the background is Tiberius's nephew, Germanicus Caesar. Germanicus Caesar was a general who was married to Agrippina the Elder. Agrippina the Elder is the granddaughter of Augustus. She was the daughter of Julia the Elder, and therefore the sister of Gaius and Lucius. Those two boys had died. So she is the new dynastic linchpin. Germanicus was hugely successful. He is married to the granddaughter of Augustus, and therefore their children are the descendants of Augustus Caesar. So here we have the potential line carrying on. Agrippina is enormously popular, not exactly for the pudicity, although she'd done everything right as a Roman wife. She'd had a large number of children. She's hugely popular with the army. Tacitus said she was impatient for equality, thought she was in a bit too much of a rush to be up there among them. She asserts herself enormously, but she becomes a problem for the state. Germanicus and Agrippina went out east when Germanicus was sent out to sort out the details in Syria, and unfortunately in the year 19 he dies, leaving Agrippina with no husband. This places her in a hugely vulnerable position. She has to return to Rome with his ashes and with the children that she travelled with. She comes back to Italy and is then subjected to a huge amount of persecution by Tiberius. And Tiberius is being led on by Sejanus, who, as you can see, bore an astonishing resemblance to Patrick Stewart, the modern actor, in the days when he still had a toupee. So Sejanus was the Praetorian prefect. He had designs on becoming emperor, at least getting his family in. He was having an affair with Livilla, who is Germanicus's sister. Sorry about all the names. But of course, he eventually gets rumbled. But he had encouraged Tiberius to really brutalize and destroy Agrippina the Elder. But eventually, when they get uncovered, they too are destroyed. Sejanus is killed. And Livilla, an important member of the imperial family, becomes subjected to damnatio memoriae, the literal damnation of her memory. And that she's the first Roman woman to whom that happens. Now, rattling on ever so quickly, because I can see time's waffling on. So we've got to a situation where Tiberius is dead in 37. Who on earth is going to succeed him? Well, they turn to, Tiberius turns to Caligula, who is the son of Agrippina the Elder and Germanicus. He is therefore directly descended from Augustus Caesar. And this is of enormous importance to the dynasty carrying on. Caligula is the preferred option to Tiberius's grandson, Tiberius Gemellus, because Tiberius Gemellus is not descended from Augustus. Tiberius Gemellus is actually still around, but Caligula bumps him off very quickly. So we now have Gaius Caligula, the Roman emperor. His mother is Agrippina the Elder. His grandmother is Julia the Elder. And then you get back to Augustus. But he's also descended from Octavia and Livia. So all his credentials are superb, but none of it comes down a direct male line. He also has three sisters, Agrippina the Younger, Drusilla, and Livilla. And these, or Julia, sorry. And these three are the ones with whom he is alleged by some to have had incestuous relations. He knows that amplifying the memory of his mother, Agrippina the Elder, is going to be of enormous importance. So therefore, to him, because his mother Agrippina had been destroyed, he restores her memory. He personally recovers her bones, brings them back to Rome, and produces coins to commemorate her, knowing that her standard, her status as a victim of Roman state politics, amplifies her qualities as someone who'd withstood evil, and therefore it will make Caligula a better emperor. That's the tombstone, ossa the bones there of Agrippina, and he goes on to list his line of descent from Augustus Caesar. And if you're wondering what that picture at the top is, that is a modern painted version of a statue of Caligula, and that's probably what he looked like. That is almost certainly what how he resembled. He gets assassinated in 41. There's so much I could say about Caligula. I could be here for hours talking about it. That's a whole different issue. But of course, he dies, he's murdered, assassinated. His wife and child are murdered as well. Who is going to succeed? And they turn, the Praetorian Guard, appoint Claudius, his uncle, Germanicus, his brother, to be emperor. Claudius is not descended from Augustus. But he is descended from Livia, and he is descended from Octavia. So he's got some dynastic credentials, but they only come through the female line. His wife Messalina is also descended from Octavia. So there are the family dynastic credentials, but they're not top notch. There's his lineage again. So on the left we've got Octavia. At the top we've got goodness me, that's his mother Antonia, who's descended from Mark Antony, and on the right we've got Livia. So again, all a female line. Now, the Empress Messalina, she turns out to have designs on becoming Empress, and she's got two children by Claudius, Octavia and Britannicus, but she is alleged to have been notoriously unfaithful. And she, in fact, plans to have a bigamous marriage with somebody called Gaius Silius. And she even has this marriage while Claudius is out of town. And as a result, Claudius is told the news, discovers that his wife has been giving away all sorts of things, all sorts of imperial treasures. And she and her lover, Gaius and Silius, are just about to try and topple him. Fortunately, he rumbles it, and Messalina has to be executed. So who does he then turn to? He marries his niece, Germanicus's daughter, Agrippina the Younger, who, of course, if we look at the bottom right, there she is. Her mother is Agrippina the Elder, Julia, and back to Augustus. Agrippina comes to the throne with the Augustan descent that Claudius doesn't have. She also has a son, already, called Nero. Well, not yet. He's Lucius Domitius Ahenobarbus, but he's now going to become Nero. She brings with her a son descended from Nero, from Augustus. As a result, incredibly, Claudius is prepared to accept the sidelining of his own son, who's not descended from Augustus, and Agrippina does everything she can to wheedle herself into the dynastic descent. That's an imperial cameo from the period, and it shows Germanicus on one side with his wife Agrippina the Elder, Claudius and Agrippina the Younger on the right. So we've got this extraordinary situation where the wife on the right is the child of the two on the left, but the man on the right is the brother of the man on the left. So, but it's all to do with putting the dynasty together and consolidating it. There's the coin that I mentioned earlier. Within a few years, Agrippina, who is one of the cleverest people of this whole period, she has got herself on the coins alongside her husband. And notice, if you look on the left there, she is Augusta. There we start to have a word that is the female equivalent of the Augustus. So Augustus had almost become a synonym for the emperor. Now we have the Augustus and we have the Augusta. And there she is. Yes, she's behind him. No other woman managed that. And she is extremely influential over Claudius, and he knows it. And he seems to be prepared to allow that to happen. There's another coin with her on one side and him on the other. We've got now a remarkable level of equality, although, of course, she holds none of the offices that he does. She can't hold the consulship, she can't be tribune of the plebs, or she can't have the tribunician power, she can't be declared imperator. Nonetheless, there she is alongside the emperor. Claudius adopts her son Nero, and Nero, because he's older than Britannicus, Claudius's son, he really takes precedence. Caratacus, the British tribal leader, comes to Rome in the 50s AD, and Tacitus, the Roman historian, is disgusted by the fact that the British tribal leader, who comes from an island where women can command tribes and lead armies, he pays Agrippina equal respect with Claudius. Romans are appalled by this. Agrippina obviously loved it, but a British tribal leader recognizes her power and influence. But let's not forget, she's only there because she is Claudius's wife, despite her dynastic credentials. But as Robert Graves would have it in I, Claudius, and some of the Roman historians, she is out to get rid of Claudius so that Nero can become emperor. And then she can rule through her son. And there's the poisoned mushrooms going into Claudius's mouth in 54 AD, which kills him. Nero. There he is. He looks quite civilized at this stage in the proceedings. So, the son of Agrippina the younger, grandson of Agrippina the elder, great-grandson of Julia, and then he's descended from Augustus. But he's also descended from Livia, and he's also descended from Octavia. He's got the fantastic dynastic credentials that any Roman emperor at that stage needed. But it's all down the female line. Look how far you have to go back to get to Augustus. This is the only reason he is made emperor at all. And now look at where Mummy's got herself to on this coin. Now, I don't know what you make of that. It's perhaps just a clumsy design. He was alleged to have had incestuous relations with his mother, but I point out to you that Roman historians love to make that kind of insinuation and allegation. It was a way of emphasizing that it was her evil, her decadence, that was responsible for Nero's degenerative behavior. So really, that's a very important part of how the Roman mentality works. A bad mother, a bad wife, she will bring down her husband because of her failings. So she is the one who is fundamentally blamed for Nero. Now, of course, Nero's only a teenager, and like all teenage boys, as he gets older, he doesn't really want to have Mummy bossing him about. And there you see, that's from Aphrodisias in Asia Minor. There's Nero on the left. He's been crowned by his mother. Look at what that's saying. You're only emperor because of me. That's what she's trying to say. But at the same time, it highlights her huge vulnerability. Because does he really want to have to accept that? Does he want to have to admit he's under his mother? Of course not. Nero gets himself a girlfriend. He is, in fact, married to Claudius's daughter, Octavia, but he doesn't want to have that. Nero arranges for his heavy mob to come up with a plan for a collapsing boat to kill Agrippina, his mother. So the collapsing boat idea doesn't go well because Agrippina manages to swim to shore in the Bay of Naples and gets back to her house. And therefore, she escapes being murdered by Nero. Nero, therefore, sends round his mob just basically to bump her off in her house. And she brandishes her womb and says, "Yes, strike that. That's what bore Nero." And she's out of the loop. She has paid the ultimate price. She has achieved an extraordinary level of unofficial power. But she was trapped in the fact that she could only exert it through the medium of her son, Nero. And that relied on Nero acquiescing in that relationship. And therein lies the fundamental vulnerability for any woman of power in the Roman world, because none of her power is official. None of it exists in any legal sense. It's all through that indirect route of influence. And if a man turns away from her or destroys her, she cannot continue in power. Nero confronts his mother's body, and it's really sort of rather a sick description. He falls in love with his mother's beauty at that stage, which is an emulation of something coming from the Trojan War, actually. But he's his new girlfriend, Poppaea. She's a cheerleader in Roman historians' accounts for decadence, immorality, and self-indulgence, hence the bathing in ass's milk and all that sort of allegation, and wearing see-through clothing and plucking pubic hair. So it's all in there, it's all in Pliny the Elder. And she is highlighted in all those works as being somebody who is another example of a dominant, dangerous, degenerative woman contributing to Nero's ever more disastrous reign. She's supposed to have lived at this place, at Plontis, near Pompeii. She certainly owned land there. Now, in the end, Nero kills her. He kills her when she tells him off for going to the circus too often, and not only does he kick her to death, he also kills their unborn child. It is a truly revolting, repellent story, and it illustrates again the enormous vulnerability of women within this system. But I would emphasize the number of men I could have mentioned who've also been destroyed and killed along the way are almost countless as well. It's all a thoroughly unedifying environment, really, for everybody involved. Nero's frustrations, he's an inadequate sort of man. The Romans see him as an effeminate man, lacking all the necessary male characteristics to rule. And all that is attributed to the influence of people like Agrippina and Poppaea, bringing him down. And eventually, of course, he commits suicide in 68. And with him ends the whole dynasty. That is, there are a few other outlying members of the Julio-Claudians who carry on for a bit, but they're all totally peripheral, and they fade out of the story. Now, almost at the end here, if we jump on over 150 years, we come to the Severan dynasty, and we have the next second longest dynasty in Roman imperial history. And we have a remarkable situation again in which it's the women, it's only because of the women that that dynasty exists or survives at all. So Septimius Severus, his wife Julia Domna, and his sons Caracalla and Gaeta. And to cut a long story short, because I'm going to have to wind this up, what happens after her son Caracalla is killed is that Julia Domna's sister, Julia Maissa, these are all Syrian elite women. They come from the east. They have a much stronger sense of a monarchical tradition. She decides that they are going to have the power. She's got two daughters, Suemius and Maissa. And the great thing that these three men have, they've got a fantastic advantage. They've got no husbands. They're all dead. They're all out of the way. So these women can do what they like. And the two daughters have each got a son. Perfect, because the sons will be the medium through which they will rule. So Julia Maissa presides over all of this. Suemius's son, unfortunately, is Elagabalus. Now, the trouble with Elagabalus is that he's a promiscuous homosexual and a fanatical follower of a sun cult. Now, in Roman culture, that doesn't really flag you up as an ideal Roman emperor. So, not surprisingly, he gets bumped off after 4 years when the Praetorian Guard turn against him, and Suemius gets killed. What does Julia Maissa care? She's got another daughter and another grandson. She just turns onto that one. So Mamia now presides over the reign of Severus Alexander, who's a much nicer boy, and actually survives in power for 13 years. These women even got to the stage of establishing a women's senate. They take it on a whole stage further, but they also spend their time copying Julia and Octavia. They use the same. Julia Domna is Julia Domina. That's what it's compressed for. That was Septimius Severus's wife. So they have taken it on to a whole new level of women's power, but they too get destroyed. So in 235, Severus Alexander is killed along with his mother, and the dynasty is destroyed. Now, it's not the longest dynasty, but it is remarkably, it's the second longest dynasty in Roman history. I'm not talking about the second century, because none of those emperors were descended from each other, and there's a very tenuous family relationship with them. The true dynasties, family dynasties, the Severan dynasty, is the second longest one since the Julio-Claudians. Isn't it incredible that in both cases, they are only carried down through the female bloodline? It's an astonishing feature of history. After Severus Alexander, Maximinus I takes over, a brutal military emperor. This point, the Romans have had enough of women in power. And now what we have is an endless succession of brutal military emperors. And it will resolve itself later in the 4th century with the House of Constantine. And the Roman world turns into a different type of state. If you jump right on into the 5th century, you do start to get some women reoccurring, one of the most famous of which was Galla Placidia, who did have real imperial power. So that, I barely scraped the surface of all of this, as you'll appreciate in the time I've had to talk about it. It's a very interesting story. There's a lot of paradoxes and traps within all of this. There's a lot to think about reflections of our own society and also the way things operated in antiquity. But nothing is going to alter the basic bald fact that the only reason we have a Julio-Claudian dynasty to talk about and discuss about at all is because it was handed down the female line. Legacy, there we have the temple of the divine Augustus and Livia, which stood in Rome just below the Capitoline Hill, long gone, nobody knows exactly where it was. And if we rattle on a bit, the Roman historians, this is a very important part of the story. Now, I'm coming very close to the end, but I really want you to notice this, because I was really struck by this aspect of the story. These Roman historians start to become current in the early Middle Ages when printing comes along. When I was teaching the Wars of the Roses, I realized that Elizabeth Woodward and Margaret of Anjou, these highly assertive women, in the Wars of the Roses, when you look at the medieval chroniclers, they are using the same phrases about them as Tacitus and Cassius Dio had used about the Roman empresses. The same criticisms, sometimes actually the same words. So this negative depiction of these super powerful medieval women asserting themselves in the 15th century is to some extent indirectly created by the Roman historians' depiction of Roman empresses. A very important consideration if you're going to look at that period. And you have to be interested in both periods to be able to see that crossover. I mean, when I was reading the Chronicles, I thought, God, that's actually a phrase straight out of Virgil. And it's just been integrated into a sentence as a description of Margaret d'Anjou. So these women were seen as covetous, power-hungry, over-dominating, stepping outside their sphere. And all of that was adopted from Roman historians. And then Seymour, Lady Worsley, who you may have heard of, famous for her many affairs. She was actually described in the 18th century as the Messalina of the modern age. So people have used these Roman rhetorical devices to reinforce this pejorative and negative image of women. As for Agrippina the Elder, impatient for equality, she's still waiting. Thank you very much.